Just last month, Greta Thunberg, a 16-year-old Swedish environmental activist, sailed across the Atlantic Ocean to attend the UN Climate Summit in New York City. Her motives to do this were purely environmental, but she actually attracted a lot of press around this and raised awareness of the carbon emissions that planes actually use. Greta refuses to fly. If she has to go a distance, she takes the train by preference. And a lot of people are now joining her in this more eco-friendly mode of transport. By 2030, Deutsche Bahn hopes to transport 260 million passengers to their final destinations. This requires a lot more than just investments in infrastructure and new trains. This requires a lot more technology as well. Artificial intelligence and high-performance computing are at the forefront of this movement. And here to talk a little bit more about this topic is a member of the executive board at Deutsche Bahn, Professor Dr. Sabina Jeschke.
Ladies and gentlemen, so happy to be here with you today. I already had a little time to spend around walking through the halls, having some discussions, communications. I have been listening to some of the other talks. So great location already now. Thanks for having me, and thanks and congratulations to the organizers. What I would like to do is to talk about a new era of mobility. And this new era of mobility is driven mainly by two very strong trends. And the one trend is the rising ecological consciousness of people. Everybody tries to find ways to move to do transportation as, let's say, ecological as possible. We have a strong movement in the people, in politics, in societies, not only in Germany, but all over, let's say, Europe and over the world. So greenness is the one big thing, or the one big driver, why we have to reconsider the way how we move and how we transport. And there's another big driver, and this is a new lifestyle patterns. A lot of you, like perhaps also myself, we're accepting long travel times, long commuting times, like every day, because we want to live, let's say, outside, more close to the forest or to a sea or whatever. But of course, we come in to work in the cities. So more and more people are accepting travel times, commuting times on a daily basis of 1, 2, or even 3 hours. And if you do so, then you want to do something useful in this time. You don't want to stand with your car in a traffic jam, right? You would like to sit somewhere, you want to be driven, you would listen to music, you would perhaps download a video, you would like to telephone or to do whatever you want to do, to use a train or a bus as kind of your private office extension, which is much more sensible and useful than sitting in a traffic jam with your own car. And these both drivers, the new kind of lifestyle patterns together with ecological consciousness makes that we have to come up with new solutions for mobility and transportation. And so this is what I'm going to talk about today. How can we use digitalization? And you have heard I'm a full professor for mechanical engineering for AI. So I would like to talk, how can we use AI? You may find AI kind of abstract. I will show you it's not. It's a very, very practical tool. And we can use it here and now. I would like to show you I can use AI to, well, not solve the problem, but to contribute to a new era of mobility. Personally, I'm always convinced that you can shape your future much better if you have some clue about the past. And therefore, I'm going back to the first industrial revolution. And I mean, everybody comes, I mean, what comes into your mind if you talk or if you think about the first industrial revolution? Steam engines, new production technologies, of course. And of course, this is true, this is very important, but for the people on the street, for the kind of everybody, steam engines in trains were much, much more important than in just the production technology. Steam engines integrated in trains allowed for the first time for a mass mobility over long distances, which was unthinkable before, at least for the majority of the population. It brought people to places which otherwise I would never have been seen. And it brought people together which otherwise never would have met. Europe, the United Europe, is a consequence of this enhanced mobility, and trains have been a very, very important tool within this movement. These steam engines integrated in trains are so powerful that they even changed our mental models. Because I mean, a distance which is very, very far away, if I can travel it in just a couple of hours, then this distance kind of feels shorter. So my geographical concept of the world is changing when I'm capable of moving very fast. So mobilization, mobility has done a lot for us and for society. In the second and third industrial revolution, it was kind of quiet. We kind of tunneled through. It was okay. We used some of the new technologies coming up, automation technologies in the second industrial revolution. But it was not so much talk about trains at this time. And now we are coming into the fourth industrial revolution, and the question is, okay, how are we going to position ourselves now? And before I go into that, let me perhaps address the biggest challenges we are facing in railway industry, mainly in Germany, but also in Europe right now. And you may have your own list, because I believe a lot of you are coming here with trains, so you might have your own list of challenges, right? Let me give you my favorite four. The first one is capacity. Capacity on the tracks. We are in the Ruhr-Köln area. You find all the ICEs very, very full. And you might ask yourself, why, Sabina, can't you just bring in some more ICEs, right? And the reason is, I can't, because the track is full. Railway systems works like that. You have a train, next train, and in between you have the block distance, and you're not allowed to go under a certain distance because if the first train is having a break, the second one has to have the chance to break as well, right? So there is a certain distance, and from that you can conclude that after a certain point the track is full. And this is exactly the case here in the Rhine-Ruhr area. The track is full. Therefore, we cannot squeeze in one single ICE. So capacity is a very, very big issue. People want to run and ride the trains, but we cannot put more trains on the tracks, at least not in the areas they really need it. The second problem is the technological heterogeneity of our system. Railway is a very, very slow-moving system. Our components are very, very stable, and therefore we have components in our systems which are 100 years old. Very safe, very stable, and the best thing I can say about them is, in terms of cybersecurity, they are great. They communicate to nothing, so nobody can hack and attack them. But I mean, we want to bring all these components, the switches, the tracks, the trains, in kind of a communication situation in order to improve the system. And now tell me how you do that with 100-year-old components, make them communicating to components I have built in just by yesterday. Okay, so heterogeneity in technological aspects is a very, very important point. Number three, you might feel that in your areas as well. Human resources. We are facing kind of a double effect. We have the demographic change, meaning that over the last kind of 20 years, we have been losing 20% pupil leaving the schools. It's a dramatic effect, and it will strengthen itself over the next time even more. And also, we have a certain trend that everybody is going for Abitur and universities. But in transportation systems, in railway systems, in all kind of mobility, we have a lot of people coming from vocational education, apprenticeship. So, and this double effect on a demographic side makes that we are really looking for people, and in the future we have to come to new automation technologies in order to be capable to move you all from A to B. And my final point on the challenges side is, we are lacking speed. Andreas Scheuer wants us, our Ministry for Mobility, he wants us to ride double as many people by 2030 in the trains. First of all, we do not know how to do that. Second, we do not need the solution in 2030. We need the solution right here and now because the trains are already full. And the railway system is a very, very slow-moving system. Regulations, planning times, everything is very, very long. So we have to find solutions to speed up the whole planning procedures and the whole building blocks. And this is my first challenge. And now, of course, not I cannot solve everything of that, right? But at least it can give some contributions. We are now in the fourth industrial revolution, and of course, everybody has some explanation what that might be, and I have a very short one. 4.0, this fourth industrial revolution, is a dramatic breakthrough in the intelligence of technological systems. Or in other words, and very short, it's a breakthrough in artificial intelligence in a style we have never seen before. Let me give you a very easy example to make clear that AI is not just, you know, fancy stuff and science fiction, but it's a very, very practical thing. Consider you have a storm, very hard storm, and you know that we then have the trains within the stations. We don't let them run on the tracks because a lot of trees are falling on the tracks, and this is really very, very dangerous if you hit such a tree with high speed. Okay, so trees falling on the tracks. After the storm, it takes hours for us to come back in business to run the trains again. Why is that? Well, because simply we do not know where the trees are. They are showing themselves somewhere on the tracks, and there's no way of knowing where exactly they are, because there's no way of knowing what's happened on the tracks, so I have to walk along all the tracks or use some kind of trains run along the tracks, or what we do now is we use drones, go over it and check 33,000 kilometers to finding the trees. I mean, is this a sensible way to solve this problem? Well, definitely not. Why can't we have some kind of sensors in the tracks which tells us, oops, here's something which should not be here? Why can't these sensors have a little intelligence to communicate about their unusual situation? Why can't we have connectivity to the sensors so that we get all the data together, analyze them? And why can't we kind of have some intelligence to see, okay, this pattern, tree here, and so on, and then the automated action would be to wake up some coworkers and to chain a drone with a chainsaw. And this is what happens in the fourth industrial revolution. The old picture is you have a unaware, unconscious, single, stupid, not connected system on the one hand side. This is the old world. And the new world would be, you have a system which is not intelligent in a human style, but which is intelligent in such a way that it can feel something about what's going on, it can communicate about, oops, something is different, what's wrong here, and by that it can steer automated actions, namely wake up the coworkers. And this is not voodoo, and this is very simple to understand, and this is the entrance into artificial intelligence, making things intelligent based on data-driven AI. Let me give you one more example, because when people talk about AI today, they usually talk about these kind of examples, the data-driven AI. I believe that there is another string in AI, another field, which is fascinating, and perhaps in the future will be even more powerful than the data-driven one. Let me give you one more example, which has nothing to do with trains. In three years ago, there was a lot of talk about the AlphaGo artificial intelligence engine. AlphaGo, would you show me? Have you ever heard about that? Oh, thanks, great. Go is a board game. It's an ancient Asian board game. It's very complicated. So if it could talk, then it would tell chess, you know, you are some kind of tic-tac-toe. So it's very, very much more complicated than chess. First thing, nobody expected that it would be possible to build an AI engine now, 3 years ago, to win against the world champion. But this was exactly what happened. So this was the first thing which was really astonishing. Everybody from the field, we expected that to happen, but not exactly, now. We expected it to happen in kind of 10 years. Second point, try to find the movie in YouTube, and you see the game between the engine and the leading world champion, Korean. And from the reactions, you can conclude that he's miffed not only because he was winning, he's totally confused because this engine was winning with a strategy no human has ever been seen or played before. So if you believe that artificial intelligence is something for the stupid stuff and the creativity will be left to the humans, reconsider your point. But the third, and this is my most important point here, my third point is AlphaGo has a little sister. That's the AlphaGo Zero engine. And they are designed in a totally different way. The first one, the AlphaGo, is a trained engine, meaning that you use all the experience from the human players, all the old parties, and this is used as test and training material for the AlphaGo. So it learns from humans, and then it's kind of built on its own strategies. The AlphaGo Zero is totally different. AlphaGo Zero has kind of an empty brain. It knows about the rules of Go, and it knows that it's supposed to win. Nothing more. And then it starts in a trial and error approach, the same way as kids do if they play blind man's buff, blinde coup. You just do something. If it brings you closer to the goal, you repeat it. If it brings you away from the goal, you try something else. So this is, in a nutshell, how trial and error AI is working. The scientific term is reinforcement learning. And these reinforcement engines are so powerful that if AlphaGo and AlphaGo Zero are playing against each other, which one is winning? It's the AlphaGo Zero, the one without the brain at the beginning, which is just based on trial and error. Why am I mentioning that so intensely? Because, first of all, it's a very powerful tool. Second, I have a lot of political debates and I'm giving a lot of talks and very often also in panel discussions, I'm confronted with the issue, well, how can we, the Germans and the Europeans, how can we compete with US, with China? They are so far advanced. Google, Facebook, Baidu, they all have the data. We don't have the data. Okay, try with reinforcement. There is another way to be very, very good in AI. We have an economic chance. You just have to know about it. So this is why I would like to address this point. And now, you might say, okay, Sabina, we understand that you are enthusiastic about AI, which is perfectly true. But please, could you just consider to make the trains run on time and also perhaps with a working coffee machine, right? So this is the issues you might have in mind. I am a pragmatic person and I have some experience. But, you know, I personally believe that digitalization in general and artificial intelligence in special is one of the biggest chances we have to improve our systems. You have already heard my train on or tree on track example. Let me give you some more. You come to a train station in the morning, a train is not running. Why? Well, probably because something was wrong and it could not leave the maintenance station. Right now, trains, repairs, maintenance are done on schedule. It means that you drive after certain hours or after a certain number of kilometers, you drive into a maintenance station and get some checks and, if necessary, repairs. Consider yourself. Are you going to your doctor every Friday morning at 10 o'clock? So medicine by schedule? Well, nobody would do that, right? You go to your doctor when you feel some kind of pain, when you feel unwell. So we would do it situatively. You would do it on demand. And this is exactly what we have to do for the rail systems. And again, it's AI. we have to bring in, and we already do, a lot of sensors into the trains such that we know in advance what is going to happen. Train running from Berlin to Munich showing a certain problem right by Leipzig, and if I know about that, I can use perhaps a 3D printer in Munich, which we do, by the way, to produce a spare part for then if the train comes to Munich, I can repair it within a matter of minutes. So it again, it's a question of artificial intelligence used. I've been saying at the beginning that one of our strongest problems is a capacity issue. And one of our biggest projects at Deutsche Bahn is DSD, Digitale Schiene Deutschlands. And what we do here is we put a lot of sensors in the trains, and in the tracks. And these sensors are capable of communicating to each other, which means that you kind of link trains to each other. And by that, you can reduce, I've been describing this block distance, you can reduce the block distance, but still be on a very secure side. Because if the first one has to break, the second one is to break in exactly the same time in real time. By that, for a German network, you can gain 20% of capacity without building one single kilometer. 20% is 7,000 kilometers. So once from the north to the south. And this is a practical example of AI. And my third example is, I've been saying at the beginning, people want individualized mobility, but not necessarily based on individual cars. So I'm living here, I perhaps might take a bus to come to a train station, then ride a train, and then for the last kilometer, if it's not raining, I'm using a rented bicycle. But if I have a luggage, then perhaps I might take a bus or so. We are 80 million people, plus some tourists, and you have a three-dimensional optimization problem. Different modes, trains, buses, planes, taxis. You have different vendors, the Lufthansa, the Deutsche Bahn, and so on. And you have the individual profiles, because some people always ride the bike, others never, some as me only if it's not raining. So you have a three-dimensional optimization problem with 80 million people. And this is nothing you're going to do with a traditional mathematical linear optimization. This is deep learning. This is AI. And this brings me to my last technological aspect for today. AI will face kind of different streams. And the power we are seeing of AI right now in here is mainly driven by algorithms. You hear a lot about deep learning, neural networks, reinforcement learning. So the power comes from the algorithms. The next big thing, we can have a talk about that next year, is 5G. Because 5G will allow to bring kind of all amounts of data you are looking for from A to B with more or less no time in between. So latency time is so small that as a human you do not feel it. And this means that the data availability is enhancing dramatically, and this will make data-driven AI again much more powerful. But now the third stream is new trends in hardware, in high-performance computing. This is HPC, high-performance computing. You have heard about Moore's Law. Who? Well, some room for improvement, ladies and gentlemen. So Moore's Law, in a nutshell, tells you if you take a chip for a computer, computational power, then after 18 months, you will find a chip which is just half the size of the one before, but having the same computational power. And after 18 months again, after 18 months again, after 18 months again. So it's miniaturization. But now, Moore's Law is coming to its end, simply because if you reduce the size, then at some point you come into submolecular structures. You come from a classical mechanical stuff to the quantum computing, and then the chip design does not work any longer. And this is exactly what's happening now in the next 3, 5, 7 years. And we will come with new types of computers, namely quantum computers, which by these days you find in the newspapers more or less on a daily basis. And these quantum computers will push AI again on a next level because their computational power, well, not at the beginning, but after some steps, will be so powerful that we will start to simulate systems which so far we have not been even starting to modulate or to design, because you already knew we cannot compute them, but we will start to do so. We will be capable of computing. Our example for Deutsche Bahn, you know what I want to do? I want to kind of squeeze the whole Deutsche Bahn system with all its components, switches and tracks and stations and trains. I want to squeeze the whole system in kind of a physically correct computer game. This would be a digital twin. Digital twin means a physically correct digital image. Because if I had that, if I had the Deutsche Bahn in kind of a second life, in kind of a simulation, then I can do experiments which so far I cannot do. I could, for a week or so, try with a totally different time schedule and figure out whether it would be better or worse than the one before. I could even simulate accidents in order to find out where carriers are kind of having weak points. By that, improve security. Or knowing, in case something happens, which spare part I'm going to need and which procedure to apply. So what I'm lacking today as a technology boss of Deutsche Bahn is I have no possibility for experiments, because I have only one, the real system, and this, of course, I cannot experiment with. So HPC, this third step in artificial intelligence, gives me totally new possibilities to improve the system, also in terms of punctuality and a working coffee machine. So you see, nothing is more practical than a good theory. Let me come to my end. Germany and a lot of other nations in Europe, we have been very, very strong in engineering. But we have to consider that in the digitalization era, actually, we are not exactly front runners, right? Everybody talks about US, about China, Korea's coming. And we do not see a lot of, let's say, strong movements in Germany. But we have the power, actually. We have the power, we have the engineers, we have the education. All industrial revolutions have been accompanied by a phenomenon which is called the vendor change, meaning that the leading nations, the leading companies, the leading whatever, kind of left the picture, versus new players came into the picture. And I mean, tell me, 2011, the Google car in San Francisco streets, how come that a computational department, a Google, a search engine, is coming up with the first autonomous car, making it into the history books, and not a Daimler or a Volvo or a Toyota, so one of the traditional companies? This is vendor shift. How come that the most sold e-cars today is Tesla? A company 15 years ago was not existing more. This is a vendor change. And we really have to fight against this vendor change if we want to stay in the poor position of engineering. So, and by that, ladies and gentlemen, I think we have work to do. We have not only to together be much more open-minded against technology, embrace technology, we have also the need to go into a leader position in a positive way to attack the market and make people go. Thank you so very much.